thank you all for coming to Science versus Fiction. This is only the third installment of this series. And our aspiration with this series is to think about science in fiction differently than just sci-fi. And I know that I've heard you say, Darren, that sci-fi has been hijacked by lust for technology and a kind of fascination with gadgetry. Did you really say that?
I don't remember that. I don't know. I could have said that probably when I was making pie, and it was because I couldn't afford to make any cool gadgets. Now that I can afford to make cool gadgets, I'm like all for it. So I think I was probably talking about, because pie at the time was really not seen as a science fiction film. People were like, they didn't know what to think it was. So I was kind of pitching this whole idea of like it's science fiction of inner space, not outer space. And so I probably was saying something about
that. Like science fiction of the mind.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so you set out, I actually want to go back a step. You have done some scientific research. You did some field work, is that right? In Kenya and in Alaska as a student, a young student interested in science. What was that work on?
Well, it's a great organization that still exists called the School for Field Studies. They're in Salem, Massachusetts. And they mostly take college kids and train the next kind of wave of ecologists and environmentalists. I kind of stumbled on a catalog as a kid from South Brooklyn. A bunch of my friends worked at the...
You did point in the right direction, actually.
Did I? Yeah, I know
that
which
is
way
south.
It is.
South Brooklyn.
It's like right that way.
Yeah.
And... a lot of kids from my neighborhood would work at the aquarium. You could get a free internship there. And one of my friends brought back this catalog. And I thought it was the coolest thing in the world, where you could spend a summer in these incredible places. Mm-hmm. So I kind of convinced them as a high school kid. I was taking AP bio, so I got into it. And the first year when I was 16, I went to Kenya to study water strategies in ungulates.
Oh, as one does.
Which are animals that stand on their hooves. And then the second year I went to Prince William Sound and we studied thermoregulation and harbor seals. So it was very intense.
The through line through all your films. Yeah.
But no, I think the learning the scientific method at that age, the best example of how great it was the program in Alaska. We were in kayaks, about 15 of us, for about 6 weeks. And you had to bring, it was deep bush, so you had to bring everything with you for 6 weeks and then take everything out because it was minimum impact camping. So we only had one textbook and it was Origin of Species. And we just worked our way through it in 6 weeks, and each week we read a chapter or whatever and worked our way through it, which was like just an amazing experience to be reading Darwin in that full natural environment.
And do you think that that had a genuine impact on your point of view, what happened next? I mean, you were a social science student in college, is that right?
Not really. You said
when the mic was off, and then you said not really.
No, I got to college, and I was a public school kid from Brooklyn, and I decided to study social theory, but it was really, really hard. When I got to school, I didn't know, I had never heard of Karl Marx, but I thought it would be a really smart thing to kind of learn about all that stuff. But luckily, my roommate in college was an animator, so I would write these papers and get B-minuses, and he would get high and get A's for making little animated films. So I was like, there's something wrong going on here. So I help him with his cell animation and fill in all these cells. And then I eventually took a drawing class, and that kind of sent me down the path of the creative arts.
So you are, out of school, young man deciding to make his first real film, which is Pi. I do have a clicker here. And you decide to make a black and white film about math and God. And, well, I mean, you have nothing to lose. Is that how you felt? I have nothing to lose. I might as well make...
No, it wasn't. Well, maybe a little bit. I did go to film school. And then I went to Sundance, I guess, in the mid-90s. And the year I had a friend that I went to film school with. And it was the year that Welcome to the Dollhouse and When We Were Kings were both at Sundance. When We Were Kings was that great Muhammad Ali documentary. and Welcome to the Dollhouse. If you haven't seen it, you should see it. It's a really great middle school film. And what it taught me is that if you make your own, is that funny that I called it a middle school film? I guess it is kind of funny. But
haven't you said like it's junior high is what you...
What?
Junior high would be the...
That's what I would call it, yeah. But it's middle school. But anyway, so I just saw that if... What Sundance showed me is that if you make your own film and you do it well, there's an audience for it, no matter how unique it is. So leaving that Sundance, I was just like, I'm just going to make what I think is interesting. I was reading a lot of Philip K. Dick at the time, and I just kind of weaved together all of these different things I had been thinking about, and Pie sort of emerged only 7 months later, and that's what we mm-hmm. went out and made.
And I mean, Pie is really interesting in that the main character also does voiceovers, almost as though he's reporting in a laboratory notebook or something. And he has this kind of mantra of 3 points, right? Mathematics is the language of nature. What was the second?
It's been a long time.
I do know this. Everything around us can be represented and understood in numbers.
Right.
And the third was that if you graph those numbers, patterns emerge. Therefore, there are patterns everywhere in nature.
That doesn't quite hold up the logic, but it's good for like a pop sci-fi film.
But he struggles through the logic.
Yeah.
He goes over it and repeats it and kind of tries to understand it. And what brought you to kind of distillate the mantra in that way? Because it is repeated at least three or four times in the film.
I don't think it was in the original screenplay. I kind of remember writing the voiceover in post. I've always journaled a lot, so I was, the way he talked about dates and numbers was very much how I did my journals. And then reducing the world to those three laws that he kind of was looking for, I don't really know where we stumbled on it. I do remember having huge debates about with Sean, who's the star of it, and you know, about if how much we believe that there were actually patterns going on. But there was just enough going out there. I had a math teacher in high school. I took an elective in high school, and it was kind of early kind of, what do they call it, like magical connections of numbers. And I remember him telling us all these crazy things about pi, like in Chiapas, if you take the height of the main temple by the base, I don't know if it's really true, you get a much closer representation of pi than the Egyptians used. So I was like, oh, that's cool. So I remember, I think it started with the idea of like, it would be cool to start with a protagonist who was just really into calculus. For some reason, I thought that was great because I think I failed calculus in high school. So I thought that would be interesting to like learn about.
Genius.
Yeah.
You could do calculus.
And so that's where it started. I also had been exposed to like early kind of Kabbalah ideas of this, the idea of turning the Bible into a long string of numbers, which people do and look for patterns. Mm-hmm. So it just sort of all came together.
So just in the unlikely event that some people haven't seen Pi because it became such a cult classic, it is the story of this kind of lone character. And there is the kind of classic idea of the hero as the lone protagonist who's acting upon the world, who is obsessed with trying to crack some pattern that he's struggling to find in the world. And you just mentioned the Kabbalah, and there in comes not just number theory, but then numerology. He somehow falls in with a religious sect that's obsessed with the numerology of the Kabbalah. And how did that come to you? It's basically the black and white film about math and God.
Yeah, well, it was originally gonna be like Pythagoras monks wandering around.
Oh yeah, the Pythagoreans, like they committed suicide and stuff.
Yeah,
they
there was like a whole cult with them. It was another thing I learned from Mr. Schneider and Edward R. Murrow High School. And I always thought that was cool. And I had backpacked around Europe and I had you see monks walking through the streets of Naples and it would be like, whoa, that's cool. But as I was writing this in New York, I was like, oh, there's no monks. How, you know, seeing a monk walking around. And then one day I'm on a bus and I'm like looking at a Hasid and it just kind of flashed. I was like, oh, they've even dressed the part. They're in black and white also. So they're perfect. And then I was like, oh yeah, they have that whole kind of mystical mathematical thing. So it just was a real kind of aha moment, looking for this kind of religious element. And that kind of connected.
And why were you looking for a religious element?
I guess they're looking for order in the universe in their own way, in the same way that kind of mathematicians and scientists are looking for it. They're just different ways of kind of approaching it. But actually, they kind of end up, at least in Judaism, they end up using similar tools.
Now, the film speaks to themes that are going to, at least from my gleaning of it, be prevalent through a lot of your films, which are obsession, transcendence, immortality, then death, which doesn't go well with immortality. You know, there's God, there's math, there's science. Did you know that these themes would kind of stick with you for quite a while?
No, I don't think so.
Do they, or do you think I'm mistaken about that?
Look, there's a lot of differences. Some of the things do show up. It's been pointed out to me.
It's like therapy up here.
Yeah, it's not so fully conscious. It's more stories that I'm attracted to. Noah, people talk about it as a religious movie, but it's actually, for me, was not religious at all. It was all about mythology and myth and how these religious stories are actually more powerful as myth. Mm-hmm. If you think about the great Greek myths, Icarus, you just say that word and it means something for people. Yet with the kind of Bible stories in the Judeo-Christian tradition, people are more fighting over who they belong to, mm-hmm. which makes them not powerful at all. But if you turn it into myth, it suddenly can be very impactful to people.
Mm-hmm. Now, we have a lot of films to talk about that in the end
Go out of order?
What was it?
Sorry.
He lobotomizes himself. I assume it's okay if I have spoilers for a film from 1998.
Yeah. Well, actually, so it's going to be the 25th anniversary of Pi in January.
Okay, so no spoiler alerts.
No. And so one thing I did when we sold it at Sundance 25 mm-hmm. years ago, I was really inspired by Jim Jarmusch, who owns all of his films, great independent filmmaker, for Jim. And so I was like, there's no way you can own this forever. You have to give it back to me. And they were like, no. And I was like, you have to give it back, otherwise I'm not selling. And they were like, all right, 25 years. I didn't think, and now it's 25 years. So the filmmakers get it back, and we've scanned it at 8K, and we're remixing it with an Atmos mix.
What do those things mean?
8K is, most movies you see are 2K. Sometimes you see, some people have a 4K TV. 8K doesn't really exist right now.
This is resolution?
Resolution, 8,000 bits or pixels, I don't know. And then we're...
that's why you didn't want to explain it.
Exactly.
Because you didn't really know.
And then we're doing an Atmos mix, and we're going to release it on March 14th, Pi Day, at IMAX. So get your tickets now. There are no tickets yet, but that's coming. So anyone who hasn't seen it,
I could talk about Pi all night.
Yeah.
But I want to begin to move on, because here you become the darlings of the indie world, right? Pi becomes, was it surprising to you? I mean, you made this on a shoestring with money from friends and family. Is it surprising to you how successful Pi became?
Yeah, it was great that it got us all over the world, and it allowed us to get Requiem for a Dream made. I had written kind of a more mainstream film, thinking I would never get this made, and then the success of Pi allowed us to do Requiem.
And we're listening to the Requiem. I know you've had this long-term collaboration with
Clint Mansell.
Clint Mansell, the composer, and you've basically described the entire film as mounting to the climax of this composition. And it's interesting, when we were talking about Requiem in the context of science versus fiction, at first blush, you might think it doesn't fit in. We should do the synopsis for those who haven't seen it. Do you want to try? Or do you want me to try?
I think, who hasn't seen Requiem for a Dream?
Don't admit it.
It's like
don't
one, admit it's like, it. There's like eight people. Hugh Howey saw Requiem for a Dream. I don't believe that. Maybe Alice.
I'll give the your partner Alice has not seen it. I'm going to have a talk with her afterwards. So the premise superficially would be that it's these young people and their relationships.
And an old person.
And an older person, all of whom have fallen into addiction, filling a kind of a hole, a void, and a compulsion. And they also become obsessive about the addiction. But in some sense, they're very ordinary people to begin with. There's nothing exceptionally terrible about them, right? They're not depraved. But yet, they all fall kind of victim to addiction. And I wanted you to talk about the music since we're playing it. It was such an important part of your collaboration.
It was an interesting thing. It was, so Clint was, when I met him during Pi. Basically, we hired this woman, Sue Zimmerman, who was this great music supervisor she was a publicist for early electronic music. So she represented Autechre, Nine Inch Nails, all these amazing bands in the 90s, and she was dating this guy, Clint Mansell, who had just, his band Popweed itself, which was kind of a rock band from England, had broken up, and Clint was kind of drunk on her couch, and they were dating, and she was like, oh, you should get Clint to work on the music. And it worked out really well with Clint. It started with one piece of music, and then it turned into the whole score for Pi. And then when Requiem came along, he was living down in New Orleans with Nine Inch Nails guys, with Trent. And he couldn't figure it out. But when he had read the script, he sent me an old cassette tape with a few sketches of ideas. So I flew down, and we like spent a few days trying to figure out the music. And then I was like, let's listen back to that first tape. So like about the sixth track was the sketch of whatever they call this track. It's called.
Lux Eterna. Yeah.
Lux Eterna. So it was like a sketch, and I was like, oh, that's interesting. And I said, oh, let's put that at the beginning. Let's put it over the opening scene. And we put it over the opening scene. We're like, oh, that's cool. And then we were like, oh, let's put it over this. And then we basically started taking different pieces from that first initial thing he got off of reading the script. And it basically became a roadmap for him to flesh out. And that's how it happened.
Mm. Amazing. It is an amazing
story. He made more money
score.
On this movie. From this thing was like... I mean, they played it at the Rose Bowl before the game. So like, and then they played it. He's like a huge football fan from England, and his team up in Nottingham played it, and like he made him sob and stuff. So it's like
because he had no idea, right? I think I heard the story. They just come out onto the pitch and they're playing his score.
Yeah, exactly.
And he had no idea.
Freaking out.
So the idea that this film might not have science influences, I think personally is mistaken. It felt to me very mathematical that there's this way in which maybe it's not in the storyline, but it felt to me to be in the directing and that the frames get closer.
That's true.
And that there's a mathematical pace. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, there was actually. Well, the whole film is a movement from wide shot to tighter and tighter shots. It starts off very wide at the beginning, and then it gets into extreme close-ups as the film progresses. But one thing we did do is, for the final kind of climax of it, when all hell is breaking loose, is it's really cut mathematically, where we basically were like, okay, we're going to have 8-frame cuts, then 6-frame cuts, then 4-frame cuts. And so it was kind of like a snare drum.
Fewer and fewer frames.
Yeah, to make it speed up to the explosion at the very end.
And they were also timed in a certain way. I know you've talked about these kind of hip-hop montages that you were interested in that era, and they're timed in a very specific way. You're timing with the music, like in the way that music is mathematical, the entire score is, or the entire scoring of the visuals is mathematical.
Yeah, and I think there's a science to addiction, I think, also. And I don't know if you could, I guess biology is it, but the thing that was so interesting about the book when I first read it was that what Hubert Selby Jr. wrote, which his classic is Last Exit to Brooklyn, which was actually set in this neighborhood, and is well worth reading for everyone from
Red
Hook.
And Requiem for a Dream is the title of one of his novels.
Yes, it was his like 1978 novel. Last Exit to Brooklyn came out when I was first getting into film, and I was extremely jealous, and I hated it, but it's actually a really great film, and a great interpretation of that material. But the book is amazing. If you haven't read it, it is set in this neighborhood. So I read Requiem, and what was amazing about it is that he was able to show how the psychology of addiction, it doesn't have to be with hard drugs. It can be with food and chocolate and coffee, and how the kind of psychological mind works in the same way when it deals with substances.
You've talked about even addiction to TV and to hope. And in some sense, all the characters are kind of addicted to hope.
To a dream, a requiem for a dream.
To a dream, yeah.
He talks about the American dream, but...
Mm-hmm. Well, it is a very gorgeous film. It's a very brutal film. So here you come out of the success of Pi, and in some sense, you kind of said it, you could do whatever you wanted, but you decide to do a film that everyone's like, oh my God.
I was like, I kept the
horrified.
Chips. I kept the chips in. I was like, let it ride. That's kind of been my gamble the whole time. I put the chips back in, and I'm just like, oh, let double or nothing. Let's
and nobody wanted to fund this film.
Pardon?
People didn't want to fund this film.
Oh, no, it was very hard. It was very hard. I remember like a week before we shot, one of the investors calling me up, and he was like, we were going to give you 4, but now we're going to give you 2.
And yet you don't think to yourself, well, if these major investors who believe in me...
They were minor investors.
These minor investors who believe in little. Did you ever think, oh, nobody's going to like this film?
I was hoping that nobody would like it. No, I don't know about that. I read the book, and it was so interesting, and it just filled me with excitement. That I don't really get that whole thing of, I just keep seeing it. I'm always surprised how thin everyone's skin is. I just feel like it excites me when things go off the rails. I love it when I'm surprised in films. That's kind of what I live for, is to see something I haven't seen before.
You've also said, just before we move to the next film, is that there are something like 150 very subtle digital effects in this film.
Yeah.
Was that right?
I guess it was the beginning of...
And you were already using like the suit for Ellen Burstyn, who plays the mother, who's going through kind of this weight loss obsession. And
that's true.
You were already using the prosthetics, and then there were all of these sort of very, very subtle, because the film's realistic.
Yeah. It's actually, you say 150, which back then was probably an impressive number, because no one was really doing digital effects. I think the whale, which is totally naturalistic, probably has like 3,000 little effects. So it's completely changed, because now you can basically use Photoshop and film and do incredible things. This film was done photochemically, so we didn't have a digital internegative. It was all, now for people who don't know, you basically take the film into a computer and you can shape it in so many ways. But back then it was really like, oh, add a little bit more cyan. Oh, too much magenta. You know, that's right. Basically how far you could go with it.
So let's talk about your next film, if I can get my gadgets working, The Fountain. So I know that one of your longtime collaborators is Ari Handel. And Ari became involved in this project. Was this when he first joined you in the creative sphere of filmmaking? Ari's a neuroscientist, right? He got his PhD in neuroscience. How did you convince him to come work in film?
Well, he was my college roommate, and we would sit around in the apartment he lived in with other roommates of his and talk about our ideas. And then Ari would come back from the lab, and he would basically figure out the story problem like instantaneously, like, oh, how about the girl does this? And we're like, oh, that's good. After we were talking about, so he was really smart. And he was basically disillusioned with academia and didn't really want to continue postdoctorate. So I pitched him to like, let's work on a screenplay together and come up with a story.
Do you want to do the blurb on Fountain? You want
me
to try again?
I have no idea what it's about to this day.
I was kind of trying to trick you into finally telling everybody what it was about. Well, you could say on the surface, just for those who haven't seen it, it's the story of a man and woman who are in love. The woman's dying of cancer. He's a scientist. He's seeking a cure. But it also takes place in the past and the present and the future. And you use that kind of triangulation to reference things as old as Mayan cosmology and as futuristic as spaceships that don't require propulsion.
Oh, spaceships
don't. This is your spaceship.
They don't require propulsion, do they? Once they're going, right?
Unless they're going somewhere.
Yeah, exactly.
Once you're out there.
You just keep going.
Just keep going. So why won't you tell anyone what the fountain is about?
Oh, I mean, it's out there. I talk about it a little bit. But part of the fun of the fountain was that it's a puzzle box, and it's supposed to be constructed in conversations afterwards, as long as the emotion works.
I've heard you say that you could take the entire film apart and put it back together totally differently, and that would be a fun project one day.
No, that's not so true. There were two versions.
Take that up with your former self.
Yeah, exactly. There was another version of it that was more similar to the script that we changed in the edit room, and it was like which favorite scene am I going to sacrifice? But at a certain point, I let it go, and the film is what it is. Mm-hmm. But there was a point where I was going to slightly assemble it slightly different.
Now, you did talk a lot about the Mayan cosmologies here. How did that take root in you, this idea of...
It's a long story, but when I was in college, I somehow ended up at... In a car that cost me $1 and two cases of beer with two friends from Boston, down in Palenque, Mexico.
I assume they brought the beer with them.
Yeah,
so
no, the beer was
like...
No, we traded two cases of beer for and $1 for this car.
Oh, for the car.
And it was a really shitty car, and we ended up at a Mayan ruin in Palenque, which is southern Mexico. And we met this kind of drug dealer / CIA operative who convinced us to come with him to Belize. Anyway, it was a very scary situation, but he was really deep into Mayan ruins. So if you picture the Yucatan for everyone, there's actually a road from like the bottom, like kind of the armpit of Mexico, straight across to where Tulum is. It's like the straight line, and it's actually built on an old Mayan road, trade route. And on either side of the road are all these Mayan ruins that were like small little trade posts and small towns. And he made a stop at every one. And so it kind of opened my eyes to like, oh, it's not just Tikal or Chichen Itza. There's actually this whole civilization that we don't really hear about it. So it just sparked my interest in that kind of... And then I just read a lot about the Mayans over the years.
And the Mayan priests really did use their scientific cosmology as leverage because they could make predictions. Yep. I mean, it's incredibly powerful. They were real scientists. The astronomy was phenomenal.
Yeah, I think I heard one theory I was telling, basically that the plazas were often, everything was lined with stucco, and there's one theory that they actually filled it with a very thin sheet of water so that it became a mirror at night. And they would watch how the stars moved across so that they could actually have a rectangle to actually pinpoint where the stars were crossing, and that's how they kind of charted how the cosmos moved.
So you also make a very specific reference in the film to the Orion Nebula and this kind of triangular formation where the vertices are these stars that were in fact studied by the Mayans. So the film has a past that references this Mayan history. It has a present where this doctor is trying to save his wife, and there's a very abstract future, which is the selects that we're seeing here. Did you think of those as referencing that triangular formation?
Supposedly that was a big part of their founding myth, their hearth in their homes. They had three stones. Supposedly it was in reference to the Orion Nebula, the triangle that comes off one of the stars in the belt and the two legs. And in the center of that is the Orion Nebula, which they called Shababa, which is where they believe souls went when they died. This is all based on their kind of cosmology that's been handed down. Because the Mayans are still around. They don't live in their Mayan cities, but they have villages and they have their traditions and they've held on pretty well to a lot of stuff.
Now, those themes that we talked about in the beginning are also present here. There's the obsession of the husband doctor. There's this obsession with immortality, It's not just saving his wife. The themes in the past, the present, the future reference immortality. And he thinks death is a disease that can be cured. Do you think he's right?
Well, it's funny, when we wrote that line, death is a disease like any other, and there's a cure, and I will find it. We actually cut it from the movie. And then it kind of kept me awake at night that it was out of the film. And so I had to make kind of a deal with the studio to get it back in, which was complicated, but I got it back in. And I'm actually glad it's in, because it's not so science fiction right now. It's interesting how much the world changed, because I've been talking a lot about this, because I just did this TV show on longevity, Limitless, with Chris Hemsworth. And it came out of that. But it's funny, because back then we thought it was too crazy of an idea. And now there's billions of dollars going into longevity science. So it's interesting.
Well, that also is one of these interesting consequences of filmmaking, that you think you can affect the world, and then you do affect the world. You can change the course of research. You can change the course.
I think all the boomers were getting old and they're afraid to die.
So okay, never mind.
I'm not going to give it to my snotty little Gen Z kid. Fuck that.
It's not life imitating art. It's art influencing life,
predicting
or it's just boomers.
It's just boomers.
So you mentioned documentary, and you do have quite a lot. I don't think people realize how much work you do in documentary, both as a director and a producer, and just an influence of what gets made in documentary. But that weirdly does bring me to The Wrestler. So you make The Wrestler next, and we've been discussing these kinds of, as you said, the sci-fi of the inner world, and what some people have called a psychedelic fairy tale. And then you make The Wrestler, which is almost reality TV. It's almost
like a
doc. But you know what I mean? The way it,
yeah.
The style.
Yeah,
it's
almost
like a doc. You don't hallucinate. There's no unreality. There's no delusions.
He has a delusion about his life, but yeah.
But it's in the range of normal. And so how does it come to be that you decide? I mean, your range is unbelievable in terms of your styles, that you've really hit your stride, and you're in this fantastic position with, you have stars on your films, and then you decide to do this really incredibly moving, completely different film.
Yeah, there was a lot of reasons that it emerged. I had been thinking about making a film about a wrestler for a long time. It was definitely in my kind of Microsoft Word file about movies to make. And I was like, I couldn't
understand. Lots of people have that file.
Yeah, exactly.
They're not as well-filled as yours, yeah.
This is like a list of like 12, 15. We've gotten to about six of them, so I got a little more work there. But it was, I grew up, when I was a teenager, I liked wrestling. And I thought it took me a long time to actually realize it was fake. And probably a little too long.
That's so sweet.
Yeah. I knew everyone saw wrestling as a complete joke, but there were so many people that were so into it, and the wrestlers were so into it, that I knew there had to be something. And it took me a really long time to find the art in it. But I spent a lot of time with some of the heroes I had when I was a kid, talking to them, and that led to it. And the style of making it, I think, when I first started studying film in college, we started off studying cinema verite, D.A. Pennebaker, and all those kind of early documentaries, and the Weissmans, and I always loved that style. And at a certain point, it became really clear when I cast Mickey that anything could happen. And what was happening was really him. And so that's the thing about the guy, is like, he's very honest in what he is, in all of his darkness and light, and that's kind of what came through in the character.
With the attributes that were interesting, like obsession and fixation on, if not perfection, just a fixation on a goal, on a fame, on, and...
Well, I think it makes him empathetic, because you could understand the commitment and the beauty to what he loves, even though it's crazy. it was really his art, and he was fully committed to it. But maybe it's not always art. It's also just giving a great show. Mm-hmm. So.
And he also suffers from this kind of delusion of hope, in the same way that some of the characters in Requiem do and in Fountain do, this delusion of the hope of succeeding in this obsessive goal. And
do I pay you now or later?
Yet there's this moment, so it made me think of Pi. So there's this moment in Pi where the character is basically living in a surrounding that looks like the interior of the computer he's obsessed with, Euclid.
Yeah. Well, that came out of actually a New Yorker article that we read a while ago about these guys. You might know who they were. They were two like Russian mathematicians that built a supercomputer on the Upper West Side and were calculating Pi, which was like an early idea for it.
It's going to take them a long time. It's infinite.
Yeah.
It's an infinite number of digits.
It's more about just testing how quick and how good your computer is, right?
Yeah.
Back then, now it's a joke, I imagine, right?
Well, no, but I think the interesting idea about Pi was that there's a number that's calculable that's infinitely long, but it's calculable. And so the game was, how can you write the shortest, fastest computer code to start churning out those numbers? And that was an interesting, you know, concept, where there are irrational numbers that are uncomputable. But so here comes Euclid, this computer that he's kind of inside and kind of building, and then Euclid becomes self-aware and breaks at the moment of, or Max thinks it's self-aware.
We've been reworking it, and I was like, oh, that's really badly written.
No.
But I guess for like 90s kind of cyberpunk sci-fi, it's kind of cool, but you know, it doesn't really hold up with what's going on right now.
But the interesting thing for me in this parallel of The Wrestler, which seems like a completely different film, is there's this hope of the character, and then he becomes self-aware, almost. He realizes he's never going to reunite with his daughter. He's not going to have a successful relationship with this woman. And in that moment of self-awareness, there's kind of this transcendence.
And happens in The Fountain, too, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, very much. And I noticed that you use this kind of white expanse for that moment of transcendence, as opposed to literally talking us through exactly what happens next. Can you tell me about that whitewash of that moment?
Well, it's just an easy cheat for everything.
I don't believe
lets
you.
Let's people read into it.
I don't believe you.
We wanted to bring Max into this state of transcendence, and so it was a super low budget film.
Mm-hmm. So. But The Wrestler too. Again, we hope no spoiler alert.
Is there one in The Wrestler?
Well, it's not a whitewash, but you suspend the moment.
That's very different.
Tell me how, as a filmmaker. Tell me how.
Well, I do use whiteouts in different ways, but that's just he exits the frame. And I think it's about, you know, what is, it means a lot of things, but for me, it means what's left once the performer leaves the stage. Mm-hmm. So it just felt like a poetic ending. I don't think it was in the script that he jumps through the frame. It's like he leaps off the top rope. But when we were shooting it in the edit room, I was like, oh, let's just hold it. Mm. And just it just gives the moment for the audience to, he's left the film. Because he's basically in every single frame of the film up to that point. And then suddenly you're without him. So it's probably more of an emotional thing for the audience.
It's a tremendous ending. And this idea that it's kind of styled realistically in like a doc, and that you've done documentaries, and you are very much supporting documentaries of a certain style with an intention. A lot, they're all science-based as far as I can tell. One Strange Rock,
Limitless,
Welcome to Earth, Territory, which you're supporting. So you have a very, there's an intentionality in the docs that you're supporting. So given fiction and nonfiction with expressing these scientific themes, how do you choose where to invest your ideas?
Well, I think we're committed. My company, Protozoa, is to promote science and also human connection. That's the two, I think, important things to do in this moment in time. Mm-hmm. So all of our work is sort of circling those two ideas.
Mm-hmm. Here we go to this absolutely exquisite film, Black Swan. I debated whether or not to turn the music up. on watching this. It's a stunning scene. And what was amazing to me is her movement is so choreographed with the music, but it works so beautifully regardless. It's just the music's in her motion. Recap of Black Swan. Come on, you have to do this one. Don't make me do this one.
It's about a ballerina who is afraid of getting replaced, I guess. And she is scary. And Swan Lake's involved. I don't know. I'm not good. I'm not good. All I remember is when I was trying to raise money, it was really hard to raise the money for this one because someone told me horror fans don't like ballet and ballet fans don't like horror.
Right, so this isn't a psychedelic fairy tale. It's a psychedelic horror film.
Yeah. Is it psychedelic? I'm not sure it's psychedelic.
Oh, look, she's turning into a swan. That's pretty psychedelic.
It's more like a were-swan movie.
Vampires, werewolves, and were-swans.
It's cool that that effect actually holds up pretty well.
It is stunning.
That was really hard to do.
Oh, actually, it's really interesting. Tell us about this effect. Yeah, tell us about it. Cause
it was really hard. It took, I mean, that's probably version 85 or some crazy amount. It was just super hard to do. It was a very original, meaning it was one of the original ideas of the entire project is that at some point there's a transformation and it was going to happen during this moment of the dance. And it just took forever to do. It was an incredibly difficult ballet move, so there was face replacement to do it. And then, of course, there's this whole morphing happening. But just how to make wings, arms turn into wings was really complicated.
And that raises the point that in The Fountain, which has a lot of these beautiful scenes of nebula and just these sort of gorgeous things happening. You refused to use CGI. All of that was done through chemical processes.
Yeah.
How is that done?
Well, I remembered that that's how effects used to be done before there were digital effects. They were done with what they called cloud tanks, which were basically tanks of water with different types of inks and different types of substances dumped in and shot in different ways with different lighting. And I knew these guys in Oxford, this guy Peter Parks, who was shooting all different types of weird effects through a microscope, and I thought that was a really fascinating idea. It was at the time when digital effects really weren't aging very well. It was early in digital effects, and I felt, you know, if you want a film that's going to be watchable in 4 or 5 years, you want things to look great. And then I had the idea that, you know, probably things that are happening on a micro level in a real chemical formation might actually reflect somewhat of what's happening on a larger level. It wasn't that there were no digital effects. It's that all the elements were shot as chemical reactions. And then we brought them into a computer and we manipulated them a little bit and layered them, slowed them down, moved them around in different ways to create.
So literally you'd have yeast growing in a petri dish and you'd have a microscope and it'd be like postage stamp size and you'd have a camera like looking through the microscope.
35 millimeter camera shooting it and then we'd take that 35 millimeter film and develop it and then we'd change the color and maybe bring some other elements from other photo shoots together to create the nebula and the exploding supernova at the end.
And by the time you're getting to Black Swan, the effects are much stronger.
Yeah.
And they're much more beautiful. And like you said, they're lasting.
Yeah.
They don't look dated.
One, we spent a lot of time.
Yeah.
It's interesting because it was there's a lot of face replacement in it so that she can see herself in the mirror. There's a lot of camera removal because we're shooting a lot through mirrors. All things that were extremely difficult then, which are incredibly simple to do now. It's amazing how much stuff has progressed.
Mm-hmm. It might seem implausible to you, but I feel a direct connection between the wrestler and Black Swan. Black Swan is the beautiful feminine version of the wrestler in some sense. She is equally obsessed with something unattainable, which is perfection. And like many of your characters, there's this sort of obsessive, addictive, relentless quality, maddening. They're on the verge somehow as though they're ordinary, but yet fragile.
Yeah, very
fragile.
There
wasn't a question in there.
No, it's interesting because they're both artists that are sacrificing their bodies for their art. And that was just a really, it was almost a coincidence that I wasn't fully conscious when I started it, but it was like kind of the, when I started talking about Black Swan, I was like, oh, it's kind of wrestling seen as the lowest art and ballet's kind of the highest art, yet mm-hmm. the artists themselves are both threatened by age and they're both threatened by the destructiveness of the craft. Mm-hmm. It was interesting, that the contrast.
I wanted to talk about Noah. Noah is very interesting. I think it's one of those films that people don't understand has a really strong scientific theme, in my opinion. And so Noah is, as it sounds, so I don't think we have to do the one-liner, adaptation of the biblical story. I did want to ask before I show this clip, and we are going to watch this really stunning sequence near the end, how close did you feel you had to stick to the biblical story?
Well, the biblical story is about four paragraphs long in Genesis, so there's not much to work with. But what's interesting is, you know, there's a long tradition in Judaism of interpretation. The Talmud's all about that. And so that's kind of like part of my tradition, is to actually look at that and apply it. So what we tried to do is not contradict anything we saw in the Bible, but to pull from each clue as we looked at it and try to expand it into something that could kind of fill 2 hours
and
of film.
And what drew you to these four paragraphs?
Well, the story is, when I was 13 in seventh grade, I had a magical English teacher, Mrs. Freed, and she said, everyone write something about peace. And I ended up writing a poem on Noah. It was what came out. I spent 15 minutes of the class on it, and it turned out it was for a contest for the United Nations, and I won it. And then I had to read it in front of an auditorium of people.
Oh God, I want that footage so bad.
Oh God, it's awful. But it's it was embarrassing, but it was kind of like the first thing where I wrote something and I got acknowledgement. Like, I didn't perceive myself as a writer before that, and then suddenly I was like, oh wow, you know, I did something, I won something. It was the first thing I had won. So he kind of was a patron saint for me. And so my whole career since Pi, I think after I did Pi, I actually talked to some Hollywood execs. It's like, I want to do Noah. And they all looked at me like, you have no idea what you're talking about. Because I was, you know, I had no idea what I was talking about. But a few people like got behind it. There was this powerful film producer, Linda Opes, and she like kind of pushed it for a while. But then it went away, as these other films happened. But then after Black Swan, I suddenly like was like, oh, maybe this is actually possible. So Ari and I spent a lot of time working on it and trying to turn those four paragraphs into... Sorry.
Our monitor is talking to us. Don't worry about it.
And anyway, that's what came out.
These religious themes, I have to ask that, because you are very much a rationalist in my anecdotal experience of hanging out with you, and you're very interested in science. So is the religious dimension for you personal, and is it in conflict with your curiosity about science?
As I said earlier, I'm not interested in the religious elements of it. I'm interested in the mythological elements of it. If you think about it, it's the fourth story in the Bible. And, you know, God creates man sins, is thrown out of the, and then a bunch of time goes by, and then the world is filled with evil, and God destroys the planet. And that's like crazy, that quickly that happens. And if you think about all the contradictions there, it's like there's a lot to build out of that. Like, what was he thinking, or she, or whatever you want to call God, what was the creator thinking? And it's like the first apocalypse story in the Bible, and it ends with a flood, and this righteous man has to save all the animals. So it's like, okay, there's a huge natural world statement. And coming from environmental sciences, I was like, he's the first environmentalist, which the evangelicals weren't happy with that term. But I'm like, what else is it? A guy who's going out to save all the animals and none of the humans. Mm-hmm. So... there's like a very clear statement about it. And it was great because the Pope started talking about it at the same time at the release. Pope Francis luckily had come in and he started saying similar things, mm-hmm. Including his, what's the name of that thing? The thing he wrote about the environment? There's a term.
The Pope wrote?
One of those big exegesis. Cyclical, thank you. But that's like probably one of the more significant moments in the last decade was that the writing of that and what it means for the world.
I'm so glad to hear you say that because I very much felt this film was an environmental film in a very significant way. So let's watch these 2 minutes of Noah, and I think it's really significant because it represents where the science is in this film, and also it's just stunningly done, and the environmentalism comes through for me very much in this sequence. It's only a couple minutes.
The first day, and then the formless life began to take on substance, shape. The second day, and our world was born. Our beautiful, fragile home, and a great warming light nurtured its days. And a lesser light ruled the nights. And there was evening and morning. Another day. And the waters of the world gathered together. And in their midst emerged dry land. Another day passed. And the ground put forth the growing things. A thick blanket of green stretching across all creation. And the waters too teemed with life. Great creatures of the deep that are no more. Vast multitudes of fish, some of which may still swim beneath these seas. And soon, the sky was streaming with birds. And there was evening, and there was morning, a fifth day. Now the whole world was full of living beings. Everything that creeps, everything that crawls, and every beast that walks upon the ground. And it was good. It was all good. There was light, and air, and water, and soil. All clean and unspoiled. Your plants and fish and fowl and beast, each after their own kind, all part of the greater whole, all in their place, and all was in balance. It was paradise, the jewel in the Creator's palm. And the Creator made man, and by his side woman, father and mother of us all. He gave them a choice. Follow the temptation of darkness, or hold on to the blessing of light.
Well, we know how that goes. How is it for you to watch this? When was the last time you watched this?
It's pretty
sequence?
Cool. The shot I don't like is still in there.
Oh, because you made a face. Yeah. I could see you making a face. Yeah, don't tell us.
Right, yeah. Anyway, it's still in bad. It was cringy back then. It's still cringy.
But so you're in the pursuit of perfection.
Yeah.
You do the best you can. Character.
Yeah. Yeah. It was very early on. I mean, one of the reasons I wanted to do this was to do this sequence, the entire film. Because I was thinking, you know, what was the story Noah would tell his family? He'd tell the story of Adam and Eve, his most recent ancestors and creation, because that's the story we're still telling. But how cool is it that Noah's telling that story, and it's just like 10 generations before. Mm-hmm. So it was fun. But then definitely to slide in the kind of Darwinism was, you know, mine kind of, it was interesting. They made us test this film in Peoria, Arizona. And I remember at one point we were outside, they were screening, and this guy like ran out and he's like, fuck, they put in evolution, fuck those bastards. And, like, stormed out, and I was like, yeah. He's really upset about it.
That's perfect. But that brings us to, I think, another film which on the surface doesn't seem to have any relation at all, but I think has really resonant themes with Noah, and that is Mother. And I remember the first time I saw Mother, I was very distracted. I was watching it at home. Everybody was bothering me. I misinterpreted the film totally. I watched it again.
That's why you should go to the theater.
Yes. And suddenly, so the premise of Mother's, there's a young woman and her older, slightly older husband. I don't know if that's
relevant. A lot older.
Okay. And they live this idyllic life in this big home that she's fixing up that was his home that burnt to the ground. And they kind of live in peace and quiet alone, and he's a struggling poet. That's the premise. Is that fair? I should let you do, but you told me beforehand you weren't going to do it. Do you want to do the one-liner better
than
I did?
That's the one-liner.
That's good.
That's it? Okay. And then shit goes crazy.
Yeah. And it goes bad. So the poet writes a few lines. It becomes like a false prophet. And suddenly the disciples are mobbing
his home. Not necessarily false.
Okay, so, I mean, one of the things I'm very curious about is the husband and the mother. And it seemed to me, in some sense, to also be an environmental film, as though the mother, because she's pregnant and is just about to give birth, it's as though there's this rapacious greed run amok of the resources that she's made available. Do you see it as an environmental film?
Absolutely.
Am I overreaching?
No, it started that way. It started as a kind of howl to kind of wake up people to see what we were doing to Mother Earth.
And it's not obvious, though, that that's the theme. I mean, it is subtle, the way it's
done. I buried it a little bit too far.
Do you think you did?
No, I mean, it's in there.
It's so wonderful once you get it. It's so impactful.
Yeah, that's the fun of it. It was interesting. I had the idea. I was like, oh, this is an interesting idea. I wanted to personify the kind of struggle that's happening on the planet. Thinking that if you could make it into, turn everything into characters, then maybe it's a way of grasping this larger problem we were having. Because I made this, I guess, 6-7 years ago when climate denialism was kind of the really running wild and most people really didn't give a shit. I think it's changed a lot and we're in much better position now. But at the time, people were really not that really focused or interested at all. There was some, but it didn't seem like it had invaded pop culture. So I was frustrated by that. But I didn't really know how to structure it. And kind of the breakthrough was like, okay, well, what's the greatest story ever told? And that's the story of the Bible, which I had just kind of dealt with. And I was like, oh, maybe that's the way I tell the story of humanity moving around these characters. And so it kind of blended those two together.
So the husband who finally ekes out a poem and then is mobbed at his front door of his idyllic, somewhat remote home, and then debauchery ensues. It's like every horror humanity has to offer happens in some room of this house in the span of a night, essentially. I called him a false prophet, and you said not false. What do you mean by that, that he's not a false prophet? Who is he? I didn't know who he was. Jesus, the devil?
There's one other name you're missing. Close. Anyone?
Humanity?
Right. No, humane.
God?
There you go.
I thought all three of those things were the same, but that's because I have a very poor religious education.
I think he's the poet, and he writes words. He gives words, and then the man and woman come, and then their children come, the two boys, and one boy kills the other boy, and then the flood happens in the kitchen.
Mm-hmm. It's a lot like Noah. And then God tries again. Wow, okay. I'm a little distracted. All right, well, we are at a very important moment, which is to discuss, the lighting isn't that great on this, oops, sorry. Your latest film, The Whale, which I saw recently at the screening and is phenomenal. And in this way that you can be persistent about themes and concepts, but completely, unbelievably unexpected in the medium and in the style. This is unlike anything you've ever done before. It's essentially an adapted play, is that right? Tell us about the play a little bit.
I saw the play 10 years ago at Playwrights Horizon. Here on 42nd Street, and I was just deeply moved by these characters that on the surface seem so completely different than myself, but within 5-10 minutes I started to fall in love with the characters as I got better understanding of them. And to me, that's the amazing part of movies, is that you can see a character somewhere in the world and completely connect with them. So I felt that trying to bring Charlie, the character Brendan Fraser, is a character that so many people so easily dismiss with awful prejudices would be a really interesting exercise.
Mm-hmm. The film makes much reference to Moby Dick as the whale, which is really poetically woven in, and the character is an English teacher who is clearly completely invested in language and words and writing. And I think that there's been a lot of talk, and I have to ask, in the media, by people who have not seen the film and are assuming that it's a sort of about beauty or about aesthetic. And I'm wondering, since you've made so many radical films and you've taken so many knocks, and kind of your films have lasted over time, how, first of all, do you have a reply to some of the criticisms? And second, how do you handle reception of your films in general when you launch them?
I kind of remember the work we did and the intention we had. It's interesting. It really reflects back so much on the people that are writing it, because the level of emotion that people going in who aren't looking for a way to critique it, they just want to go see a movie, has been exceptional. You know, having last weekend we had the largest opening since 2020. Mm-hmm. And I think people are, it's the first time people are getting a chance to cry together in a movie theater in a long time. And that's a great experience that used to be a lot of fun to do. We all know about comedies, we all know about being scared, but that's the third part of the Holy Trinity, is coming together to feel deeply, and the film does that. It's just interesting how people kind of, they let their, I think it's letting their immediate off-the-cuff prejudices jump to it. And they would say otherwise, but I think it's how they, it's because of the subject matter, it's really touchy. It really is one of the last places where you can be totally okay saying any prejudice. You hear it when you meet people who live with obesity, they just constantly face so much dehumanizing. You know, after the screening that you came to, there was a group of doctors there who came up to me and they were like, "You got me. I basically," and it's a long established fact that people with obesity do not get the same medical attention as other people. And they were like, "Yeah, now we met Charlie, it's easy to forget that there's a person there." And that's so obvious, but it's very easy to judge.
So I was reading, I started reading it and I abandoned it, a New Yorker article. The entire article was based on people responding about the issue of obesity, and then kind of sidebar parenthetically, the writer mentioned that none of them had seen the film. And I found that so enraging, having just seen the film, because watching it, I didn't really think it had to do with obesity at all. I thought, and again, you can tell me if I'm overreaching, it had to do, again, with addiction. It's very much about addiction. I mean, that was my reading. And obsession and pain. And again, this insane, optimistic hopefulness of this character. So I don't think it's about what people think it's about just by looking at the poster frame.
It's judging a book from its cover.
Yeah.
And judging a person from its cover. Mm-hmm.
It's actually an incredibly quiet film for you, it felt like, and extremely paced very differently. And it's so moving. It's really, I think it's a masterpiece.
Hashtag cry together.
Yes, hashtag cry together. And huge congratulations.
Thank you.
On that. And with that, before we open to Q&A, please join me in thanking Darren tonight. We're a little bit over, but I know people love to ask questions.
I love it.
Yeah, Darren loves questions. We have a mic over here. We're going to give at least 10 minutes for questions. So come line up. Right, we have a mic stand. Yeah, so come on in and ask some questions.
Where's the mic stand?
Where's the mic stand? By the
camera.
It's
over there.
By the camera.
Oh my God, I'm first.
Okay, excellent. Follow the red hat.
Don't mess up.
Follow the red beanie.
Okay, so try not to be too long-winded. So I'm a teaching artist, and I work with a lot of social justice-based pedagogy. Grew up with addiction in the home, so a lot of your narratives are really interesting to me. So I focused on cybernetics, Afrofuturism this year with the kids, because I'm thinking about this question of hope and how it can feel like, but what's there? What's coming? How do I build? And imagining together, like my teaching practice this year is about what kind of future do we want to build for ourselves? And like some of the names you mentioned, Philip K. Dick or like William Gibson, things that they wrote about became our reality. Afrofuturism, I love, looks at the past as a resource, like what's available and what we've done, rather than like, fuck it, we messed it up. And so like I'm curious, with the themes that you're building, what you're hoping you're laying the groundwork for in the future?
That's a good question. I've been thinking a lot about this, and I think it is, I think there's been a shift for myself. A lot of these films were made in the Paris Hilton era, and I was just like screaming for, hey, there's a lot of other things to think about. But I feel like there's been a shift where people now kind of believe in this kind of terrifying future that science is pointing for us. And it's now the responsibility of artists to write stories that create a promise and a future for our youth to kind of lean towards. I think dystopian fiction is a crime at this point and should be outlawed. They're making another Hunger Games. They should not be doing that. And we need to start painting what exciting futures that can come. If we dream it, then we need more Star Trek.
Thank you so much. Next question, please.
Hi, this is very simple. I'm actually a banker. And I've worked at Goldman, Credit Suisse, and next week I'll be at Bank of China. And through the ethos, through the zeitgeist, I heard that you were going to do a deal with Blackstone in the beginning of the year. And I was just wondering if that's the case, what happened?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, then it's in the ethos. It's
really?
No collaboration.
Really? Okay. Yeah. Someone Google that me and show me that headline, please.
Sounds good.
Yeah. And I don't know anyone at Blackstone.
Okay, sounds good.
Barely know what it is. I know they're kind of evil with climate, though. That's about it.
This feels like a non-linear.
I saw a video of a bunch of rabbis and priests getting arrested in their lobby, and I'm all for that.
Okay.
So get them to divest.
Fair enough.
This feels like a non-linear timeline in one of the films. It'll come back later. The end of the film.
Like autocorrect from Black Swan to Black Stone. Another red beanie.
Another red beanie, please.
Red hook, red beanies.
You've recently also become associated with another of my favorite filmmakers, Janixa Bravo. I was wondering if you could talk about what drew you to her and to the point where you're now collaborating on Kindred and just her work.
Yeah. So we did together, there's a new thing on, there's another Darren product out there on FX Hulu. We released eight episodes of Kindred. Octavia Butler's masterpiece is great sci-fi. Brendan Jacob Jenkins, this great playwright from New York, show ran it and created it. So go home and go watch it. But it's Janixa Bravo is awesome young director who did Zola, and I saw that. I thought it was badass. Her name came up as a possibility. She actually, at one point, was interested in directing The Whale. Her version of The Whale I'd love to see, too. But she's just a great filmmaker, and she directed the pilot. So... it was awesome. So, Kindred.
Thank you. Next, please.
Hey, Darren. Your art is so fearless and generous and energizing in that sense. And I often think of guys like you or David Lynch and wonder, I'm a musician, I'm an artist, and wonder, is there any point when you're making a film and you're thinking, hey mom, hey dad, this is my film, you know? Like, is there any, at any point you're thinking, am I crossing the line here? Should I worry about anything, or is it just pure raw and vision and you just go for it?
No, I mean, you're always thinking about your audience. You have to. But of course, when you're pushing the edge of certain things, you have to sit there and go, is this worth it? Like the needle in Jared Leto's arm, if you remember that sequence.
I sure do.
Most people do. It was a big debate. It was like, are we going to do this? But it really underlined what the movie was about. So we were like, we have to do it. And so it's usually that decision. It's like being truthful to what the thematic of the film is, and I always say that you don't really finish a movie till you cut your favorite shot. And I think it's often your favorite shot because somehow your ego is connected to it, either because of how difficult it was to get that shot or how well it went, and you're like, wow, that was great. There's something wrong about it and it sticks out. So usually you have to cut out that one last thing, and that's the final touch of a movie. So I think it's all about that. It's finding that careful balance, but always never forgetting where your audience is and remaining true to the kind of contract you're making with the audience. So like very early on with Requiem, we're very clear about what the journey we're going to take you on. So it's just remaining truthful to that contract.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. I imagine that you've been asked this before while touring the whale around, but it's so striking that twice now you've made films with The Wrestler and the Whale that were centered around performers, actors who were beloved but have gone through this sort of wilderness in their careers, and you've created these projects that have sort of resurrected them. And so I was curious if that is a coincidence, if you think there's an underlying reason that you've been drawn to that. Why has that happened?
It was two totally different journeys for them. I completely understood what Mickey Rourke meant to me and to like all the best actors in the world looking up to him. I knew the cool factor. I knew that there was a lot of love and curiosity about him. So that made sense to me. I had no idea about Brendan Fraser. The millennials in here were Georgia the Jungle, but I'm Gen X. I kind of missed it all. I never saw Encino Man, still haven't. Never saw Georgia the Jungle, still haven't. And Airheads, never saw it, still haven't. It wasn't my thing. But I spent many years trying to cast that role, and nothing ever made sense to me. Nothing really got me here to be like, yeah, that's exciting. And then when I stumbled on the idea of Brendan, I was like, oh, wow, that's really interesting, and that could really work. And so he really was the right actor at the right time in the right role. I'm thrilled about the Renaissance. I mean, it's freaking great. I mean, like, the love for the guy is great. And it couldn't have happened to a nicer man. He is such a gentleman. And he is really a beautiful soul. So it's been great to watch. And it's exciting now as a filmmaker and hearing from other filmmakers who are like, it's like a new color on the palette. There's no other actor in the world like him. And now you can suddenly use him. And so he's going to be around for a long time doing really great work. And that's exciting.
Thank you. Do we have another person? Okay, well, I think that is a beautiful place to conclude our conversation. I want to welcome you all to view the astronomers in the garden. And
the whale, we need your help, because there's a little movie called Avatar this weekend that we need to like... But
yes.
We're still in theaters, so after you go see Avatar, or if it's sold out and you can't get in to Avatar, we're at the Alamo Draft House, the Angelica, and Lincoln Square. Please come out. please come out.
Absolutely. Come see the whale. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Darren.